the anatomy and the kinematics of how this wrist moves. And I want you to think about what ligaments are important, right? And then chunking them into certain sections. So this comes no matter what edition you are reading from, comes from chapter 2, which is the anatomy and kinematics of the wrist. So I don't care how you draw it, right? In terms of the direction, what you see, or if you do it from your hand, you want to have a couple of different perspectives, but this is how I drew it. I draw the scaphoid, the lunate, the tricuspid, and then the pisiform, right? So this is the scaphoid, the lunate, the tricuspid, and the pisiform. And then over here, it's going to be your trapezoid, and your capitate, and then your hamate. All right? Because all the T's are crucial. All right? So then after you draw that, you have to understand that the ulna sits here and the radius sits here, all right? And this is how I draw my metacarpal, 3, 4, 5. So it's really important to understand that this row of carpal bones over here is your proximal row, right? And these bones over here that are attached to your metacarpals are your distal rows. This is your distal row, right? And what's important is to think through when you're understanding anatomy, all the points of articulation, right? And why the wrist has the problems that it has. So instead of focusing on everything about it, pick some really, really key aspects of each bone that is important to know. So the scaphoid is divided into distal, waist, and then the proximal, right? The trapezium, right, articulates with the first metacarpal. This is the first metacarpal. So we know this is then the CMC. And the trapezium has a little spot over here for the FCR, the flexor carpi radialis, right? And when I point these things out, it's usually because the muscles or the tendons where it's attached is important to know because it's going to provide stability for the carpal row, right? So let's look at where the anatomy is, right? So if we look at proximal row, there's a ligament that ties the scaphoid to the lunate, right? There's a ligament, it articulates. The ligament also is tied to the tricuspid, right, and articulates there. And then this here also articulates with the pisiform. Now the pisiform is actually not a true bone. It's actually a sesamoid and it's covered by the FCU, right? It's covered by the FCU, that tendon. So if you think about, so this is what they call, you know, interossei, like the ligaments that are within this carpal row, right? So when we go and we say, the carpal instability dissociative is for fractures or ligaments within or between the bones of the same carpal rows, it can only be that something happened to the scaphoid to the lunate, something happened to the lunate to the tricuspid, right? You have to be able to rule out anything else. Does that make sense? Right? So that's within this row. And the proximal row is the row that tends to have the most problems, right? The scaphoid essentially is a problem child here, right? When we talked about the hands, the PIP was a problem child. It was always something wrong with it. And the wrist, it's a scaphoid, right? So the scaphoid articulates with the lunate, and it actually articulates with the capitate as well, right? I'm not drawing it to scale, but it articulates because of how big this bone is, right? Now the lunate articulates with the radius, right? So it articulates with the radius and the TFCC and the triquetrum. So the lunate also, you know, articulates with the scaphoid, with the radius, with the triquetrum, and then of course the TFCC is like a big component, and the capitate. Right. So these two bones touch a lot of other bones. So anytime they touch a lot of bones, just understand that they're going to cause a lot of problems, right? And then let's see, the trapezoid articulates with the trapezium and it articulates with the scaphoid. So it articulates here, right? The trapezoid articulates with the trapezium. It also articulates with the scaphoid. It articulates with the capitate and articulates with the second base, the metacarpal. The trapezium articulates with the distal pole, right? The distal pole of the scaphoid. So it is touching. Obviously it articulates with the scaphoid, the first metacarpal, and holds the FCR. So that's all the articulations, right? So obviously this one articulates, but that's not a problem. So it doesn't really matter. If you're not a problem, I won't pay attention to you, right? So those are essentially the articulations, which also mean there's some ligaments that are holding it together, right? Now, the key thing is here to understand the joints, right? So the joints, you have the radial carpal joint, right? So the radial carpal joint. That is a joint that holds the radius, the TFCC, and all of the proximal row bones. So then if that is a joint and something happens, right? Something happens to the radial carpal level joint, that is essentially considered a carpal instability non-dissociative.
Hey therapy friends, it's Huang here. Thanks again for watching my video. And if you like videos like this that can help you just crush it in the hand therapy world as an occupational therapist, then hit the subscribe button and enjoy the video. Thanks again for watching.